conference.
So before that, there were chapters, but there was no...
Yes, around the state there were a few. There were a few NOW chapters, and there were a few other little groups in various towns. Mm-hmm. And this brought... Actually, 300 people came to that conference, which was amazing. Which was amazing. And after the conference, when we all got together to talk about it, someone suggested that we should start a newsletter in order to keep everybody together. And
so it's a communications
so we could keep mm-hmm. communicating and not let these people just go back out on their own without becoming activists. And we had made about $340 on the conference, and we gave $100 of it to National NOW because the president came and some of the National NOW issue people came and gave workshops. And there was $240 left over, and they gave me this $140 and said, "Here, Paula, start a newsletter."
But the intent of the newsletter was a communication vehicle for the chapters. You weren't imagining a national periodical at that time.
Oh, no, it was a statewide. It was called New Directions for Women in New Jersey. It was intended to be a statewide periodical. Mm-hmm. But after a couple of years, we felt very restricted to be just New Jersey. We dropped In New Jersey from the name and became a national periodical covering national subjects with national distribution.
How did you get the money to, was anybody paid?
No, at that time nobody was paid, neither the writers nor or anybody who put the paper together. Nobody was paid.
But you did charge for subscriptions?
$2.
For a year?
Per year, $2 per year.
And how often did it come out?
Well, at that time it was quarterly.
In the early days?
In the early days it just came out four times
and,
a year.
And later it was?
Later we became every other month. We never came out monthly, but, mm-hmm. but for most of its life after a while, we came out every other month, but we were bi-monthly.
I have to tell you that I used to read that from cover to cover.
A lot of people tell me they did
issue.
It.
And it, in many ways, it changed my activism.
Mm-hmm.
One area that you had several articles on was the ways in which United Ways differentiated between the amounts of money that they gave to girls' organizations and boys' organizations, and women's and men's, too.
Right.
So that Girl Scouts got less money than Boy Scouts, and girls' clubs got less money than boys' clubs. And that was the first time that I had never even imagined how United Way distributed its money. I just assumed that they had the best interests of the community at heart. And it was those articles that changed my involvement
yes.
in that. So that was...
We heard from a lot of people about how various issues came up in the paper, and it changed their...
A lot.
And people were amazed when we told them what was going on.
Now, how did you get the skills that you needed?
That's interesting.
Because you said you were in radar engineering.
Everything was learned on the job. We went into this without knowing anything about how to do it. And we just did it and learned on the job. But I must say that professional women... helped. For instance, there was one woman in a book advertising position, and we didn't know how much to charge for ads. And she said, "Well, if I were going to take an ad in your paper, I would want, say, 2 columns by 6 inches, and I would expect to pay about $60 for that."
Mm-hmm.
And from that one figure, we extrapolated
the whole thing.
The whole thing.
Did you get resistance from people in business to advertising in a feminist periodical?
Well, sure. But we did a lot of book advertising. We did a lot of employment advertising. At that time, There was affirmative act. Later, when the affirmative action came in, a lot of companies were advertising for women employees so they could be doing the affirmative action. So we got employment ads and book ads, and we did a lot of classified advertising. Women were starting to start their own businesses there at that time, and various things, and they liked to advertise in our classifieds. So
between classifieds, help wanted male and help wanted female.
The advertising, however much advertising we got for an issue, determined how many pages we were allowed to print, because so we could pay our printer, and the rest of the income came from subscriptions, and we were tax deductible, and we always asked for contributions, and we got a lot of small contributions.
And I do remember you're providing multiples of the of New Directions at conferences and conventions, so that people became aware of it that
yes,
way.
Yes, yes, yes,
and that's libraries, school libraries too.
Yes, that's we sent a lot of copies to libraries and asked them to put on their lobby shelf with the sign free. And of course, people could pick up a copy of the paper, and there was always a subscription blank in the paper, very mm-hmm. prominent, asking them to subscribe.
And that worked?
Yes, it worked.
It to me, it's amazing that you and this core of other women with no background in journalism were able to produce that paper for so many. This was before Title IX. The regulations for Title IX were not passed until 1975.
Yes.
Well, so you were really charting new territory.
Well, it made a lot of difference to the people who worked on the paper. I remember there was one woman who I gave an assignment to. I said, write an article about such and such. And she said, oh, I can't do that. I don't know how to do that. I said, yes, you do, and yes, you can, and you do it. And she did it. And she said, after that, I could write. It changed my life just because you made me do that.
That's so satisfying. Were there articles that you wrote or that others wrote in New Directions that ultimately had such an impact that you felt it was very satisfying and could be traced to any particular subject?
There's one very, very important article. I want to show you what it looked like, if I can find it here. There was a very important case about paternity leave that a man brought against NBC. It was a dad. Here's what the article looked like. Dad sues NBC in landmark
court case,
and he sued NBC because they were giving maternity leave to women with a proviso that they could come back and get the same job, and they were only giving paternity leave to men, but without the proviso that they could come back, and that's what he sued about.
What was the period of time that they allowed maternity leave and paternity leave?
This article is dated March, April 1982, and the court case hadn't come up yet, but I know that he won the case. He did win the case. So NBC had to give him paternity leave with the proviso that he could come back after, I think it was 6 months. So that was an important one.
And that must have been very satisfying because you had written it up.
Yes.
And I remember that time period because there was another important case in which the another important case in which again it seemed to be men's rights, but it was really related to gender equity, and that was the case of a man who wanted to get into the University of Mississippi's nursing school and was turned down, and again he pursued it and he won that case. But it was really women involved in gender equity that brought these benefits to men. There was a Social Security case. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Men could not get the same benefits on account of their wives having worked after their